Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our webinar tonight. My name is Dilys D'Cruz, and I head up wealth management at Meridian Credit Union. We are really excited to have Bruce Sellery join us as our speaker this evening. A business journalist, television host, and author, Bruce is on a mission to help people get a handle on their money so they can live the life they want. He's the national money columnist for CBC Radio, a regular guest on the TV show City Line, my favorite show, and the host of the weekly Moolala radio show and podcast on Sirius XM. He has written two best-selling books, including Moolala, Why Smart People Do Dumb Things with Their Money, and What You Can Do About It. I've had the opportunity to be interviewed by Bruce as well on his radio show, and trust me, he does not let us industry people off easy, as he's always pushing for the best advice and information for his audience. So let me tell you a bit about Meridian before we start. Meridian is the largest credit union in Ontario and number two in Canada. We have over 75 years of banking history, 27 billion in assets, and 375,000 members who their clients, we call them members. And we have 89 branches and 15 business banking centers in Ontario. As a credit union, we don't have public shareholders. We are not for profit, and we are focused on our community. Our members are owners, and that means any profit we make goes right back into improving our products and services, and our focus is on innovating new ways to enhance the lives of our members. And it's important to note anyone can become a member. At Meridian Wealth, we have a team of about 100 and manage $4 billion in assets. Our key purpose is to enhance the financial well-being of our members by providing them with peace of mind, a sense of relief, and optimism about their future. We truly take the time to understand our members' lives goals, and together we create a financial plan to help them get there. So I promise you, the next hour will not only be informative, but it will also be entertaining. I certainly have not met someone in our industry with the energy and passion of Bruce Sellery. And with that, welcome, Bruce.
Thank you so much, Dilys. I'm so bossy. You know, it's because TV shows never start at 6:33. They start at 6:30 on the dot. So here we are.
Here we are.
Here we go. All right. So I love to have a little fun. I don't know if tonight is going to be like finger puppet fun or if it's going to be like maraca shaker kind of fun. It's going to be some kind of fun because we're going to be talking about your moolala. So let's, I'm going to share my screen. Here I go. I'm sharing my screen. I think that worked. I'm going to say that worked. So moolala is an effort on my part to take some of the significance out of this conversation about money. People get very heavy and like weird about money, right? Very, very weird. And I don't want to be weird about money. I want to be thinking about money in the context of funny hats and cute dogs wearing sweaters and lovely little goats and slime. We need to be having a little bit more fun with money because here's the epidemic we face. Smart people doing dumb things with their money. It is ubiquitous. I got to tell you, so I'm a money expert. As Dilys mentioned, I do this stuff all the time. And 2 weeks ago, I was looking at two credit card bills at the same time. And usually they don't come at the same time. So I usually don't look at them at the same time. Looking at them at the same time, I took my own advice and I went through line by line to see if every charge was appropriate and accurate. What I realized was I was being charged on two credit cards for Spotify. This had been going on for a year and I'd never noticed it before. So someone with the email address like johnsmith@yahoo.uk was benefiting from my obliviousness by getting Spotify for free. A light little bit of fraud that I caught 12 months later. Smart person, dumb things. Some people do dumb things with debt. Like they leave money on their credit card, even though they could probably pay it off, they just don't. Some people do dumb things with insurance. They overspend on things like extended warranties and then underspend on life insurance when they've got kids. Some people spend on ridiculous things. And I'm not talking, you know, purses and bags and stuff. I had this one friend, an MBA, super smart executive in financial services. She spent $4,000 in 1 year on parking tickets. just parking tickets, just spent money on parking tickets. So there are lots and lots of areas, families not talking about money with their parents or their kids. That's not the smartest thing to do. It really is universal, unless you are a one in a billion person who is immune to this. Most of us are smart people doing dumb things with their money. It can also be an area that is so tough to talk about, can make us feel inadequate, an area where we do ridiculous things, and it can be really scary. So this is a picture of me and my mom. My mom is the least scary person you will ever meet. There is nothing scary about my mom. This picture was taken at the Moreno Glacier on the southern tip of South America. My mom and I went on this amazing trekking trip and we're in front of the glaciers. It was pure magic. And it was possible for four reasons. Number one, my mom was an experienced hiker. So she'd been to Bhutan and Tibet and Peru and summited Kilimanjaro. She was someone who was in good physical shape. We got along. And as it relates to this conversation, the single most important thing that had that trip be possible, she could afford it. So my parents were divorced when I was 10. My mom went back to work in a retail pharmacy and worked and worked and worked and was still working at age 70 when we went to Patagonia. She retired at 76. So this is a real lesson to me that I want to apply with my own kid. This is Abby. She's young there, but I love that photo so much. I want to go trekking in Patagonia when I'm 70 and she's, you know, whatever age she is. I'm an experienced hiker. I just did the West Coast Trail this summer. I've done the Inca Trail. I've toured around the Alps. I'm in pretty good shape, right? Pretty good shape. We get along for the most part, but I need to be able to afford it. That is so critical. So we're going to be talking about your moolala today and how to get a better handle on it. And specifically, there's four things I want you to take away. First, some new clarity. New clarity about your financial priorities. Second, a super simple plan so you can get started immediately. Third, some more confidence when it comes to talking about your money and have you be inspired, just inspired to get off your duff and into action. So on your screen, you're going to see a little chat box. Go find that chat box. If you can't find it, take a second to find the chat box. This is 18 months into the pandemic. You've been to virtual events before. And I want you to put one of four words in that chat box. You're looking for clarity. You're looking for a plan. You're looking for confidence. You're looking for inspiration. So I'm going to look and see in the chat box there what it is that you say you are looking to get out of our time together. Let's see, where's that coming up? Oh, I might have just stopped sharing my screen there. Did I stop sharing my screen? I might well have stopped. No, I'm still sharing my screen. Good. So I'm looking at the chat. I'm looking at I'm seeing a plan, confidence, inspiration, confidence and inspiration. Amazing. So that is my job. That is what we are going to do in our time together, is to deliver on those four things. Okay. How we're going to do that is we're going to answer this question. Why do smart people do dumb things? Like, it's not about knowledge. It's not about cranial capacity. It's about something else. What's it about? Here are the four C factors that give us the answer to this question. It is about context. It is about consequences. It is about complexity, and it is about community. Those are the four things that we're going to focus on. And if you really engage in each of those four things, I promise you, you're going to have a new insight and a new action to take to help you get a better handle on your money. We begin with context. Context, like, what are you talking about? I'm supposed to be giving news you can use and tips. And what are you talking about context? Context is the setting in which an event occurs. It is the foundation for everything I talk about when I talk about money, because it is so critical. It's like the frame. So the setting in which our conversation is occurring is amidst a backdrop of a pandemic in its fourth wave, a federal election, a booming stock market, and a very strong economy. That's all the things that are in the setting of this actual conversation. Another way to articulate this is, what is your money for? What is your money for? So not like literally, because it's probably for, you know, Uber Eats and the mortgage, but what is it from the perspective of purpose? And this is not a conversation that most of you have had before. Very few people have had this before. So I'll say it in another way, just to give you a better idea of what I mean. What's exercise for? What's exercise for? So people who exercise have an answer to this question. And for me, it is as a stress reduction. If I don't go for a run at least 3 times a week, you can see my energy level. I already went for a run today because I knew I was doing this event tonight. So I do it as a stress buster. Other people exercise for the sense of challenge. Like they want to run a 5K or they want to, I don't know, cycle the Camino in Europe or whatever. Some people exercise because of family. They want to live for their grandkids, right? Some people exercise for ego. Like they want to look in the mirror. You know, those muscle heads at the gym and they're like, you're 25, aren't you? And they exercise because they want the big guns and they're going to, oh, that's not bad. They want to do it so they look great when they see themselves in the mirror at the gym. And some people do it so they can indulge their favorite vice. That may be you, but just say it secretly. I saw this headline in the Globe and Mail, which I thought was hilarious. It said, I run so I can drink. Oh yeah, totally. So there are certainly people who run for lots and lots of different reasons. They have an answer to the question, what is exercise for? And I promise you, if your answer to that question, what is exercise for? If your answer is torture, there is no way I'm not gonna see you at the gym. You're not gonna go running because exercise, you've got a context for it that doesn't empower you or jazz you up. So let me just take a look here. I just want to make sure that you have still got my, oh, I think you do still have my screen. If Naveen, if you could just pipe in there and make sure that we've still got my screen, because it's not showing up in the way that it did before. And I want to make sure that it is. Yep, you are. Okay,
good. I could still see your screen.
Okay, perfect. So if we bring it back to money, then what's the answer to that question? What's your money for? And, you know, I say Uber Eats and the mortgage and stuff, all that, of course. But in the absence of answering this question about context in its most abstract and inspiring way, we are left with what society says our money is for and what our family says our money is for. And quite often, those contexts are not particularly inspiring. They're not particularly compelling for people. So let's start with society. The big one that the financial services industry is talking about, and particularly in January and February, and I am too, by the way, is your money is for retirement. In Belize, in an antique roadster, with your silver fox, doing yoga in the afternoon, playing piano with your grandkids, you know, playing your guitar and zipping around Malta on a green Vespa. Now, if you're on the verge of retirement, you can bet that money is for retirement is super compelling to you. Try telling that to a 27-year-old. Very difficult, very difficult. Money is for retirement. A 27-year-old's not super interested. And for years, I have really resisted this notion myself. And here's why. I want, when I hear the word retirement, I hear boring life, boring life, boring life, age 65, great life, dead. That's what I hear when I hear the word. I don't want that. I want great life, great life, great life, age 65, great life, debt. So retirement as a notion, as a context for doing the right things to get a handle on my money, so not interested, just not interested. And I think for a lot of people younger than I, that is not a context that's empowering for them. There is also the context of stuff. So in our culture, money is for pretty things, handsome things, caffeinated things, boozy things, techie things, 52-inch, 102-inch things. And the International Celebration of Things comes on December the 25th when we buy things for people we might not even like, as long as they're new and improved. So there is a context in our culture that money is for stuff. Now, some of you are, a lot of people here in the Niagara region, I love that outlet mall. It is the best outlet mall in the country. Some of you love to shop as a leisure activity. And well, you should, good for you, have a grand old time. A lot of us shop out of habit, or obligation. And it's not actually an inspiring context for us when it comes to money. So society offers up a whole bunch of stuff, and there is also what is offered up in our family of origin. So as I said, my parents got divorced when I was 10. I'm the youngest of five kids. Both of my parents grew up during the Great Depression, right? So, you know, Christmas was a tangerine is the urban legend in my family, but it meant that my mom in particular saved elastic bands, milk ties. She saved the milk bags, rinsed them out, and then that's what we took our sandwich to school in, right? That's just the way that it was. So on Christmas morning, when you received a present, you would take the present and you would remove the tape as if you were deactivating a nuclear bomb, like Mission Impossible, like you were like Tom Cruise, because you had to very carefully take the present and put it aside so you could save the paper for next year. Yeah, we save the paper for next year. So in our family, money's for survival. My stepmother shows up. You can't even imagine. The first Christmas she spends with us, she brings out a garbage bag, a big green garbage bag, and starts piling all the paper into the garbage bag to throw it out. And all the kids are like, no, you just say that. So in my family, money is very, very clear. The context for money is survival. And it's not that there's anything wrong with that. It's just as I grew into adulthood and I started to engage, like opening up an RSP, and I had a job and I had vacation, I realized that I was completely constrained. I couldn't live my life because the only thing that you could do with money is to scrimp and save it. And I had this very limiting belief. I had this full-time job. I worked at Procter and Gamble. I have 3 weeks vacation, but I couldn't spend my money until I had this epiphany. And my epiphany was this: my money is for adventure. I actually get to say what my money is for. I get to say it's not retirement, it's not stuff, it's not survival, it's adventure. So I booked a ticket in, you know, my 20s to go to New Zealand. That's Abel Tasman National Park. I had this amazing trip trekking the Franz Josef Glacier and the Kepler and the Rootburn and Milford Sound. And that has been a theme that has carried on for decades. So Abby and Dennis and I went to Vietnam. Dennis and I did the Tour Mont Blanc in the Alps. And it has been such an extraordinary theme that I don't know if I would have been able to pursue had I not created this new context for money. Now, as you can imagine, I'm going to ask you in a second what your answer to this question is. And but I want to give you one other little piece, because sometimes it's hard to picture yourself in the future. So you're like, oh, what's my money for? I don't know. I don't know what my future holds. So there's this app. It's called FaceApp. And there's a bunch of them out there where you can upload a photo of yourself in the present and it will age you. Like, it'll age your photo so you can see what you're going to look like in the future. And it's behavioral science. It really what it is. You can picture your future self. And this is a way for you to really lock and load on what it is that your money is for. So I'm sure you're excited to see the photo that I got. So I uploaded a photo and they sent me the photo of what I'm going to look like in 25 years. You ready? Hey, hey, this is what I'm gonna look like in 25 years. And I thought, I am gonna look an awful lot like George Clooney, and that is a life worth living, right? It's totally a life worth living. So some of you will answer this question and you will say, my money is for family. My money is for freedom. My money is for experiences. Like, I just want to experience stuff in the world. I want to have fun. I want prestige. Maybe you want the biggest house on the block. Fill your boots. For some of you, it's about contribution, making a difference for your family, for your community, for the world. For some of you, it's about legacy. For some of you, it's comfort. You want comfort. For some of you, it's beauty. For some, it's travel. And for some of you, it's health. In all the ways that you can define that: physical health, spiritual health, mental health, right? So I want you to just take a second and think about what your answer is. And as you think, I'm going to give you my rationale for why this is the single most important question you need to answer to get a better handle on your money. So here's my rationale. Here are the three benefits of context. The first is it gives you language. So when you're talking to your advisor, when you're talking to your spouse, when you're talking to your kids, quite often the discourse can be around RSPs, credit card payments, like and it can be a source of tension when you're talking about those sorts of things. I was talking to a couple who did one of my workshops and they said, we have been married for 25 years, happily, ostensibly happily. We have never had the conversation about what our money is for, never. And so out of that, they were able to co-create this new future that they hadn't been talking about because they were focused on the products, right? And Dilys mentioned that at Meridian, they're kind of good at this stuff. They kind of know how to have these conversations with you. You as the members need to like put yourself in that chair on that phone call and say, let's talk about what money is for, not just about the RRSP or the TFSA. It gives you language. Second, it has helps you check your behavior, right? So I had this couple who came up to talk to me after an event and they said, you know, we're really struggling. We like what you said, but we're really struggling with it. And I said, well, tell me more about your life. And they said, well, we live in this house and it's really stressful because the only way that we can pay the mortgage is if we both work flat out full time. All right. What's your money for? And if their answer was prestige, I totally would have got it. Their answer was not prestige. Their answer to that question, what is your money for, was freedom. And they had no freedom because they had a mortgage to the hilt, right? So this is a great check for you. If you say your money is for adventure like mine and you don't have a special bank account for a travel fund in which, you know, $300, $400 is transferred from that, from your paycheck account to this special savings account, I'm not buying it. You have more work to do. That's one thing you're going to have to sign up to get a handle on so that you're going to have adventure in your life always. The last reason why I'm so passionate about context is it keeps you motivated. It's your why. Why am I doing this? Why am I saving the receipts for my taxes? Why am I meeting with my advisor? Why am I? Because adventure, freedom, whatever, whatever, whatever. So go back to that chat box and give me some answers, the ones that you come up with that are for you. And it could be one of the ones that I've mentioned. You're just going to steal it. I love it. Steal with pride. It could be experiences, family, prestige, whatever it is. It is such a compelling place to start to answer this question. What is your money for? To create context. Smart people do dumb things with their money, but one thing they can do to do more smart things is to create context, to answer this question and talk about it with people so that it's alive and real in your world. The second reason why smart, capable people do dumb things with their money is consequences. And consequences defined very simply, it's the effect or outcome of something occurring earlier. It's actually not a bad thing. It's just the effect or outcome of something occurring earlier. And I love this picture of this car from the late 70s because it reminds me of me growing up in London, Ontario in the late 70s. The bell would ring at 3:10 p.m. and me and all my friends would race out to the street. And Rob Greenhow's mom would be in a car much like this, and she would open the door, like, wow, and we would pile into the car stacked like Pringles in a can, right? Seatbelts, no seatbelts. There was like imprinting on my forehead from the pattern on the roof of the car. Like, this is how many kids we jammed in there. And that is because we were oblivious, we as a culture were oblivious to the consequences of not wearing seatbelts, the consequences of fatalities and fines, right? So listen, we've learned a lot. People drive with seatbelts by and large in the Western world these days. People are now starting to be more aware of the consequences of their behavior around money. More aware, but not a lot. Because here's how most people are. If you just put your hands over your ears for a second and repeat after me. La 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 la. We just walk through life like pretending that credit card bill didn't come in. Just kind of pretending that it's all going to take care of itself because we are oblivious. Well, today, here and now, that stops. Because what we know is we've all got weaknesses. We're not perfect. Please, even I am not perfect. No one's perfect. So let's use this example. Let's say you had a weakness in savings. Some people have a strength here. Some people have a weakness. There would be a tangible consequence to that. And it would be like, I got kids. I got a weakness in savings. I've missed the 20% RESP grant and all those years of compound interest. The bigger consequence, though, is intangible. It's the one you can't measure. And in this case, maybe it's regret. When your kid's 18, you think, oh, geez, I didn't save the money that I could have saved and got that grant. And it's annoyance with yourself, maybe with your spouse who was supposed to sign up for it and didn't. So with every weakness that we have, there are tangible and intangible consequences associated with them. So I'm going to go through a list. Choose one. Do you have a weakness in income? In spending? Do you have a weakness in debt or saving or investing or organizing or communication or taking action? Now, we've all got lots of weaknesses, right? I just want you to choose the one that is most challenging for you. We all have them, right? For some of you, that communication thing is with your advisor, it's with your spouse, it's with your parents, it's with your kids, who knows? For some of you, it's taking action. Like, you're coming to this session with me tonight and you're like, dude, I know what to do. I'm just not doing it. So let this be the kick in your buttinsky there. Okay, so you've got all these weaknesses, right? You've figured out what your thing is. Then there are tangible consequences you can measure. So it could be not enough money for retirement, overpaying on interest, taxes, or fees. Do you know how many times I get the question, I have $2,000 in my bank account that I could invest in cryptocurrency or something, or I've got $2,000 in outstanding debt on my credit card. What should I do? It makes a personal finance expert crazy, because if you just pay off that credit card, it is a guaranteed return of somewhere between 15 and 30%. Guaranteed, right? Because you're not paying that interest. Crypto, who knows? Any other investment, who knows? Go for the guaranteed return of 15 to 30%. A lot of people are overpaying on interest, missing out on credits, grants, and fun. I think you can measure fun. And I hope this is like an 8 out of 10 on fun so far. There are also a lot of intangible consequences, right? So these are the ones that you can't measure, but you feel them. And in our culture, we do not talk about this nearly enough. We talk about the products and the we don't talk about what happens when you can't save or when you're not organized or you don't communicate. It leads to consequences like annoyance and regret and feeling stupid and being stressed and fearful and disappointed and frustrated and angry. Now, we know empirically, one of the leading causes of divorce is money issues. People are angry. It's not the only thing, but it's a big thing. And that's such a missed opportunity, because if you could find a way, and I'm not saying this would work in every case or even most cases, but if we could take our divorce rate down just a little bit because we mitigated the anger that couples feel about money, that would save the couple and to save our culture, our society, a whole bucket of money. And this coming from a kid whose parents got divorced, right? So the second reason why smart, capable people do dumb things with their money is that they're la oblivious to the consequences of being of doing dumb things with their money. So, you know, listen, we all have strengths, we all have weaknesses. My hope is that on the little piece of paper that you've started, you have put down an answer to a weakness that you have. And as we continue to talk and in the question and answer period afterwards, you're gonna find some actions that can mitigate that weakness such that you are someone who is addressing the consequences of your behavior around money. So you've got a context that you love. Adventure, freedom, whatever. You are awake. You have woken up to see that there are consequences that you need to address in your life. It is now time to manage complexity. So complexity, the word, is basically the state of being intricate or complicated. And some of this stuff can be really complicated. Buying on margin, options, derivatives, foreign exchange, commodities. You don't need to do any of that. You really don't. There are so many things that you can do that are very, very simple, and the whole complexity of it is a massive, massive problem. So here's my dad with Abby as a baby. So cute. The baby's cute. I mean, my dad's like, what, my dad, but Abby's so cute. For my dad, money's a hobby. So I go visit my dad at Christmas a couple years ago. He's like, hey, want to take a look at my portfolio? Because, you know, I got TransCanada 22.5. It's got a yield of 3. You know, like, dude, this is like your sport. You know, if you can't get to the curling rink or the golf course, you're hanging out watching BNN Bloomberg. He was one of the people who was most disappointed when I left BNN Bloomberg because he would like hang out with me every afternoon as I anchored the show. So my dad, money is a hobby. He has the correct level of complexity for his skills and interests. My mom, on the other hand, this is not interesting for her. She does not want to spend her time in this way. It is not a hobby. So I was a little surprised when she told me she joined an investment club. Really? Join an investment club? All right. So maybe, I don't know, 12 months later on the phone. Hey, how are things going with your investment club? Mom, what's shaking on that front? We're reading The Life of Pi. No, investment club, not your book club, your investment club. Oh, it's our investment club. Why are you reading a book in your investment club? Because our investments weren't doing so well, but we really connected as women. We really had like a soulful connection. So we decided we would stay together in the investment club and read books. But you still call it an investment club? Yes. I don't even know how to do that. So that is an example of mismanaging the level of complexities. Like, that is not the right level of complexity. Another example is a person I had in one of my early seminars. Her name was Mitzi. Lovely, lovely, lovely. And she came up very quietly. People tell me secrets all the time. She came up with this like admission. I need like a traveling confessional. Wouldn't that be so great if I could have like traveling confessional? And then it could be anonymous, except for people don't need it to be anonymous. People tell me stuff all the time. She comes up and she says, I can tell you to the penny how much I have spent on cosmetics every month for the last 5 years. To the penny, she can tell me. And then she said, and my rental apartment has been vacant for a year. For a year. So too much complexity on tracking, insufficient complexity on her residential property. So a lot of you are thinking, but there's so much to get a handle on. What am I supposed to pay attention to? It's why I invented something called the priority pyramid. This is called the priority pyramid. And this is a way for you to figure out what your specific area of focus should be, okay? So the base of the pyramid, you see on the bottom of the screen, is cash flow. Are you earning more than you're spending? If you are, you move up. If you're not, you focus on that. Then it goes to debt. And I'm talking about consumer debt, not a mortgage, because that's such low rate these days, but consumer debt, maybe it's a student loan, but mostly I'm talking about credit card debt, eliminated to zero. Yeah. Then if you've eliminated to zero, you can move to savings. So you're saving for retirement, kids' education, vacation, down payment on a second property, a renovation, whatever it is that you're saving for. Once you're doing that, you get really, really engaged on the various government programs out there, RRSP, TFSA, RESP, RDSP, right? All those sorts of things. Then you're going to look at your investments. It can be very, very simple, as Dilys will tell you. It's like not that complicated to build a diversified low-cost portfolio. It's not. You know, people are telling you there's 12,000 things to think about. You know, there's not. You could do a diversified low-cost portfolio very, very quickly with the help of someone amazing. The final part of the priority pyramid is called optimizing returns. And this is where some people, my dad, choose to try and time the market, try and time specific stocks, play cannabis versus crypto versus psychedelics. Most people have no business in the tippy top of the pyramid. They just shouldn't go there. It's not relevant for them. It's not what they should be doing. So the objective is to move up the pyramid over time. And some of you are at the level that you're at, and maybe you were higher in the past, and then you got divorced, and then you lost your job, and then you had a health issue, whatever it is. I want to acknowledge that life throws us curveballs. We're in a pandemic still, and it's so important to know that you can move up and down the pyramid, but you're effort, your intention is to move up the pyramid so you have got a handle on your money so you can live the life you want. Now, here's a simple example. For some people, you'd say you're going to your weaknesses now, right? You're looking at the weakness, maybe you have a weakness on debt. What you need is more complexity. So if you had more complexity, you'd actually have a plan, because most people will tell me, oh yeah, I want to eliminate my credit card debt. Oh, great. What's your plan? There's no plan. There's no plan. You need a plan. It's got to have something going with it. So here's a basic debt reduction plan. You write it all down on a piece of paper, the outstanding amount, the interest rate, the due date, the minimum payment, and you either do the avalanche or the snowball, right? You then review your spending to figure out how you can free up some cash flow so you've got more income than expenses. You brainstorm a whole bunch of ways you could cut. You choose two big changes to commit to and then move on from there. If you're trying to get rid of debt and you don't have a plan like that, your complexity is insufficient. So if we go through all those weaknesses, you would look and see and you'd say, there's more things I need to do. Let's say taking action for a second. If you're one of those people who knows all the things you need to do, you might even have them in a list. What you need is an accountability partner. And it could be a spouse, maybe not too close. It could be a best friend, could be an advisor, could be a coach in another context. And you just need them to hold your feet to the fire such that you do the things that you actually know to do. So smart people do dumb things with their money because they have mismanaged the level of complexity. And as you're sitting in your chair there, I want you to be thinking about, where do I need more complexity and where do I need less complexity? I want to give you like just a couple of other quick examples. And one that I would say is on the organization front, there are 50% of Canadians who do not have a will. They don't have a will. I talk to people all the time who don't have a will. Now, if you're a single person, it's still a problem, but it's not as big of a problem as if you're in a relationship or if you've got kids. If you've got kids, period, full stop, you need a will. And 50% of people do not have a will. So there is a level of complexity that is required on that front. The other area where I find people often need more complexity is in the area of communication. So I talk a lot about how do we teach kids about money. I have a kid of my own. Another area where it's so crucial to have open discussion is with aging parents. I'm not just talking about the will and the power of attorney and the power of personal care. I'm talking about like basic things about their life that they may not have revealed to you and may not be recorded anywhere, right? That's outside of a will. There's a lot on that front. So this is the time for you to start looking at what the weaknesses are and what you need to do to manage complexity. It's so, 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 so critical. So you've got a context you love. Oh my God, it's so great. You are looking yourself in the mirror and saying, I have consequences that I need to now mitigate because Bruce has pointed them out. Now is the time. I am not going to take everything on. I can't take everything on. I need to keep it simple. So my priorities based on the priority pyramid are boop, 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 boop. Awesome. So that's where we are moving to the fourth and final C factor. The fourth and final C factor is called community. And again, it's kind of like context. You'd be like, wait a second, why is he talking about community? What does it even mean? A community is a group of people with something in common. That's how it is defined. And that could be the people who live on your street. It could be the people who work in your organization. It could be fans of Harry Potter. It could be fans of Ted Lasso. It could be teachers if you're a teacher. It could be accountants if you're an accountant. It's just a group of people with something in common. And what we don't do is leverage the magic of community in ways that we do in running. So if I said, I want you to, or you want to, if you came to me and said, I want to run a 10K, what community could I be a part of? I would say, hi, Ash, you should join a running course at the Running Room. They're amazing at the Running Room. Just go do a running course there. If you said, I want to lose weight, I'd say, oh, well, there's a bunch of online communities you could join. You could join Weight Watchers, good old classic Weight Watchers. If you said, I really want to explore my spirituality and I'm looking for a community, I'd say, well, I mean, there's so many community faith groups. There's religion, there's non-religion, meditation groups. There's so many different options for you there. If you said you wanted to become a better public speaker, not that that's possible in my case, but say you wanted to be a better public speaker, you could join Toastmasters, right? So you could go join that community and participate in that way. Now, here's the my area of passion, personal finance. You want to go be a part of a personal finance community? Like, where do you go? Where are people who are interested in personal finance gathering? There's blogs and stuff. It is very, very difficult to find a community in which people are talking about money. in a compelling, inspiring way. It's just not happening. And I want to give you an example here of community, and then I'm going to relate it to the benefits of community. This is the Sellery family. Our t-shirts are green because my stepmother, with her sister's husband, created these t-shirts for Sellerybration. So we all have these green t-shirts. I think it was like the 25th anniversary. Sellerybration is an annual event. We all show up. There's 27 of us, I think. There's three parents, my mom, my dad, my stepmother. There are six kids, six spouses, 13 grandkids, three people joined by way of adoption. There's two same-sex marriages. Like, it's like a whole crazy thing. And why I bring that up is the Sellerys and the Sellerybration lives in the land of community. And it provides three magical things. Communities provide support. So, you know, when you think maybe it's not your family of origin, maybe it's your friend group or, you know, the buddies on the hockey team or the moms that you all had kids the same age and you went to the same kinder music group 20 years ago or whatever, areas of our life that really work quite often, not always, but quite often we have a community that is connected to that area because they provide support. So when you need something, your community's like, okay, I got a lasagna. I'm showing up with a lasagna. Here you go. They also provide ideas. So, and this you see on Facebook all the time, right? I'm looking for a plumber. I'm looking for a tutor. I'm looking for a whatever. Communities provide support. They also provide accountability. And so much of getting a handle on your money is about accountability. It's about just doing what you say you are going to do. And as you sit there in your chair, wherever you are, I want you to really, really think about the power and magic of accountability in your communities, because it's two things. It's get from and give to. So you can get from your community things and you can give back to your community in certain ways. And this is just such an enormous, enormous missed opportunity. I had a person stick around after an event and she was really moved, upset. She was in tears. And I, you know, as I always do at these events, I pulled up a chair and I, you know, asked what was going on. And she said, I know there are things that I need to do to get a handle on my money, and I have a sense of who I could talk to provide me support, ideas, and accountability. I just can't do it. Who's the person? It's my dad. And I can't do it because I just feel like such a failure. I'm in my 40s. I am in debt up to my ears. I don't know how I'm going to pay it, and I'm just so embarrassed. And we talked about it, and it turns out she's got a kid. Her kid was about, at that time, maybe 6 or 7. And I said, I want you to think about your kid at your age, 40, and your kid comes to you dealing with something. Forget what it is for a second. How do you engage with her? Well, you're honored that she spoke to you about it, and you as a parent do whatever it takes to support your kid. Because that's what we do, right? So her eyes welled up and I said, I know it's going to take something for you to step into the breach and talk to your dad about this and feel like there's a risk that, you know, he's not going to be proud of you or ashamed of you or whatever, but I think it's a risk worth taking. And I get an email maybe a month later to say, I broke the seal. I talked to my dad and he was amazing. He was amazing. He was super supportive. He didn't, you know, cut a check and have it all go away, but he provided the support that I so desperately needed to help me think this through. She got a new job with a 30% raise. She sold her house and moved something smaller on his guidance. So there is so much that we can get from community. There's also so much that we can give to other people. And, you know, there's been so much progress made on how we think about health and mental health these days. When someone in your life has a cancer diagnosis, you can go on Caring Bridge or Meal Train and show up with the lasagna, right? When someone's dealing with financial challenges, we're like, la, 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 can't bring that up, can't talk about that, no. Well, what if that wasn't so? What if there wasn't shame around that? What if you could say, listen, hey, I know this, you've talked about your divorce, I can imagine that's really hard. The financial aspect's a real hard part of it. Is there anything that I could do to support you on that? Because some of you, like I'm looking through the camera, some of you have an expertise in this area. And when you look at your friends and family who are going through tough times, yeah, you can bring a lasagna. but maybe you could be the one that helps them create a little bit of a budget or sets up an automatic transfer or files their taxes with them because they haven't done it in 3 years. So as you think about actions you could take in the realm of community, I really want you to think about what could you get from and who could you give back to? And some of you, you'll pop that the answer in the chat there. I should have mentioned earlier that we're going to do a draw of my second book on retirement. So if you put something in the chat, you can guarantee that you'll be eligible for this draw that we're going to have later on. So I really can't stress enough the magic of community. It really is the most extraordinary vehicle we have to help people get a better handle on their money so they can live the life they want. And we have to push back past this cultural taboo that has made it an unacceptable topic of conversation. And I don't mean asking someone how much they make in salary. I mean engaging with people in the way that we would in other areas and offering our support and in making requests. We're going to move to your questions in just a second, and you can put them in the chat. But I want to leave you with a challenge. And the challenge is this. The challenge is, before I do the challenge, community, yes. Engage community, yes. Create context, address consequences, manage complexity, right? So that's the theme. That's why smart people can do more smart things with their money. The challenge is this. My challenge is to do one thing in the next 7 days. So I went very quickly. I am a very, very fast talker. But if you think back to the last 45 minutes that we've had together, you may have had ideas around your context for money, who you could talk to about that context. And I'll reiterate, it could be a spouse, it could be a parent, it could be a kid, it could be an advisor, it could be an accountant. I don't know who could be a best friend. Just sharing that word and talking a little bit about it could make a really big difference in terms of your motivation to get a better handle on your money. For some of you, you are like looking your weaknesses straight in the face, and you're going to picture me. I hear this not infrequently. You're going to picture me on your shoulder, kind of being like both playful and barky, like, get it together, go do it. Come on, take action. So I want you to address those consequences and their actions that are required to take to do that. Some of you, it's about complexity, ramping it up in some areas, taking it down in others. And for some of you, it really is about community, having conversations that might be really tough, that might push you outside your comfort zone. But I want you to do one thing. And in a second, I'm going to ask you to put one of two words in the chat. I'm going to ask you to put either accept or decline. So I'm going to ask you to put that in the chat. Not quite yet, but in a second. And what I'm going to ask you to accept or decline is my challenge to do one thing in the next 7 days as it relates to your money and getting a better handle on your money. And the reason it is time bound is because time is precious, so precious. So I told you about my mom and our trip to Patagonia when she was 70. We traveled for years. My mom joined our family. This is my mom on the swing in San Francisco. This is 2 summers ago, summer of 19, all of her 5 kids in Gros Morne National Park in Newfoundland. Spectacular. A couple of years ago, maybe 4 years ago, we took my mom to Edinburgh, Scotland. And the thing to know about my mom is that she loves bagpipes more than anything else in the world. So anytime I hear bagpipes, I immediately well up with tears because I know my mom would be welling up with tears. And at the end of our time in Edinburgh, we attended the Royal Military Tattoo, which is on the grounds of Edinburgh Castle. Thousands of pipers while the fireworks lit up the sky. It was magic. Time is so precious, so precious. Why that trip was so precious is my mom's now 85 and she's got Parkinson's. And we just 2 weeks ago moved her into an assisted living facility. And she is optimistic and she is hilarious and she is generous. We could not go to Edinburgh today, given where she's at in this chapter of her life. Abby isn't 2 months old anymore. She's not 2 years. She's not 3 years holding her marsh pillows. She's not 5 visiting with me on the set of City Line. She's not 7. She's almost 12. She is almost 12, and time is so very, very precious. And when it comes to having that context be alive and real for you, you need to take action. You need to get it together and do one thing in the next 7 days. Some of you are going to accept my request, and some of you are going to decline. You're going to heaven either way. But I want you to take a moment to just put it in the chat, and I'm going to sit here with reverence, right? To see if you accept my request or decline my request to take action on your money in the next 7 days. So you're going to go to the chat right now. Good. Yes. Good. 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 Okay. Accept, accept, accept. Awesome. Awesome. There will be some decline. Some of you are being covert about it. You're like, I'm not going to accept because it's going to be 14 days. I'm going to do 3 things in 14 days, whatever it is. It is all fine, whatever you choose to do. Listen, bottom line, you are here with me tonight to talk about the 4 reasons why smart people do dumb things with your money. And my hope, my commitment, is that you take some of this conversation and use it. It would be a shame if it was simply a delightful time. I mean, I hope it was a delightful time, but I really, really, really am throwing myself into it, such that you take an action that is going to make a difference for you and your family. Thank you for your attention. We're going to get to your questions. I really appreciate your energy and your commitment and your resilience to be in a virtual event, even now after all these years of virtual events. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. Dilys is going to come back. Ooh, I see lots and lots of accepts. That's good. That's good. Oh my gosh, call the funeral home to prepay the end of day's journey. I love it. Beautiful. Dilys, what questions do we have? What do they want to know?
Well, you know, firstly, it's so exciting to see everybody accept. I'm loving seeing all these acceptance to take action. And there were so many things that resonated. So first question is, I know a friend that needs help, but I don't know how to go about offering help without offending him.
Yes. Okay, I love this question. So what I would do, here's how I would frame it. I would ask if you could have a direct and somewhat risky conversation. I'd ask for permission. And I do this all the time, by the way, even with people I don't know very well. Because if we slide in there without any warning, it's like, what the, what was that? What just happened? But if you say, listen, can we have a super direct conversation? And can you promise me that however the conversation goes, you will know that it is totally from my love and care for you that I'm even asking this question? And then I would say, I've seen, you know, some of the stuff that you're going through. My concern is that there's a financial impact to that, and I want to be helpful. And then you can offer up ways you can be helpful. So this is one of my favorite things to do, multiple choice. So A, I could connect you to my financial advisor. B, I could help you file your taxes. C, I could help you make a budget. D, I could come over to your house and sort through your papers. E, I could do nothing. Which do you think? Which do you want? And just have it be a light, fun conversation. And here's the other sneaky thing you can do. Say this, I was at this session with Meridian Credit Union, and they had this speaker, Bruce Sellery. He's a little too high energy, but very handsome. And he said that I should ask the question and talk about it this way. Just use me as a, throw me under the bus. And if it doesn't go well, blame me.
Well, one of the things I like you that you said, though, and not just because I head up wealth at Meridian, is that, you know, as an option is refer them to an advisor, because, you know, a lot of what you talked about in community and one of the things that we really, really stress is we want to create a safe space for people to come with their vulnerability. And so many times people don't want to talk to an advisor because they're feeling a sense of shame. And I think you talked about that with that example of that woman who felt a sense of shame. And you know, that's where we really want to differentiate ourselves. It's about, you know, emotionally connecting to people and meeting them on the journey at exactly where they're at. And so I love this idea of tying it to community. And I think it's always an option. You know, the wealth industry and investment industry has this reputation of, you know, talking up here and, you know, being very formal, and it's very intimidating. And I think that's really a differentiator. So I really love that tie-in. So how do you balance supporting or giving to community and enabling them to stand on their feet to be independent?
Whew. We could ask that question of absolutely anything. And I think one thing I would have you acknowledge for yourself is where are your values, right? So I have a very strong value around being proactive in my support of others. Not everybody has that value. So I'm the guy who hears about the cancer diagnosis and I'm like, where's the meal train and when am I baking the lasagna? Other people will stand back and wait to be asked. They'll happily bake the lasagna, but they'll wait to be asked. So I think trust your gut on what level of engagement is worth it for you. My assertion, my belief is that in today's context, we're too laid back. Back in the days of, you know, barn raisings and all these community events, the only way you could farm the land at the turn of the last century was if you had community come and clear the stumps from your land. These days, we live in isolation, and the pandemic has made it so much worse. So I would lean in. You can always apologize later and say, if I am being a nosy Norbert, tell me. But until then, I just want to be helpful.
Yeah, that's great advice. All right, so I think we have time. I'm going to give you another question before we wrap it up. Any tips to get into the frame of mind for decumulation after years of accumulation?
Oh my gosh, it's a very, and I assume we're talking not about tchotchkes and bottle openers and wine glasses, but in terms of our money, it is a very, very big, big change. And I think it really ties back to context. Because I am someone who still disregards best before dates because my mother disregarded best before dates. So that is a hard thing to move into spending. What I would do is acknowledge that you're going outside your comfort zone, have your context lead the way, and have a financial plan, either on your own or with an advisor, in which you're really clear on what that pay down is. You can have as much conservatism as you want in there, but have it be conscious conservatism in the model versus fear, right? So you're gonna make these assumptions like the markets are gonna tank and I'm gonna need long-term care for 20 years, fine. But then when you know what your burn rate can be, how much can you actually spend it. Go travel. Do whatever you need to do.
I love that. And I love this context because once you put context in about money, it takes the pressure off, doesn't it? If money is about freedom, then it's okay if I spend it on whatever is important to me, right? As long as I've got a plan in place. So I really, really love that. Quickly, somebody wanted to know names of your books.
Okay, Moolala, Why Smart People Do Dumb Things With Their Money and What You Can Do About It, which you can order anywhere online. And my second book is about retirement, Moolala Guide to Rocking Your RRSP. Dilys, I have one other thing that I want to say. And that is, so first of all, thank you for hosting me. I appreciate that. I have a great affinity for the credit unions. I've done lots of work with credit unions over many years and have a really great affinity for the people and for the intersection of your mission and the way the membership works, right? Like you really are aligned in terms of the values of the institution delivering on the needs of the members. I want to make it known that if you go to the chat box, you're going to put up a link. So put up the link now. You're going to put up a link. And if you book a conversation with a Meridian advisor, first of all, you're going to have done your action. You're going to have done it already. It'll be done. But you're also going to get a $25 Amazon gift card. And that can be your step. You know, it may not be the only step, but it will be a step. So that chat link is going to be in there. Go look for it. And take that as one of the steps that you're going to make in the next 7 days.
Yeah, we really want to get people in just to have a conversation. There's no pressure. But I'm going to say that if people choose to bring money over from another financial institution, then we actually have a program in place, an offer in place to offer 1% on any investments that come over up to $750. So some free money there. But more importantly, we want people to have the conversation. Come in for a second opinion. Come in and have a conversation. No shame. Be vulnerable. That's what we're here for. So I hope that people take us up on that offer and we have to pay out a lot of $25. So,
<That's right>.
So Bruce, it's been a pleasure. Thank you so much. I love listening to you. I love the energy. I love the idea of community and complexity and context. And what's the last one? Consequences. See, I was taking my notes.
And chocolate cake, I think.
and buying
chocolate cake
shoes.
Is the, yeah.
Anyway, thank you everybody for attending today. I hope that you found Bruce as informative as I did, entertaining and high energy. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. Take that action. Thank you, Bruce. Good night, everybody.